Before I pray for us, let me just mention a couple things. We let you know a few months back that we have selected three men who we believe are qualified to be elders, and we presented them to you as elder candidates. Just real quick, I'll have them stand up for you. Gabe and Brian and Leonard, in case you didn't already know, I'm just reminding you. And it's our goal that at the end of February at our annual meeting, which is like February 27th, I think it is, to finalize the process of making these guys elders. You can go ahead and sit back down. The reason I had them stand up, though, is because we want you to feel confident that you can sit under their leadership, that you can be submitted to them in their role as elders. And so one of the encouragements that we've been asking you to do is get to know these guys. I know some of you have already met up with them for coffee, but if you want to invite their families over for dinner or even call them on the phone, whatever. Again, our goal is that not just that John and I, who are the current elders, would put these men before you and say, this is what is going to be, but that we together as a church body, a church family, would all see that this is a work that the Lord is doing in placing these men in this role as elders over our church. So that's just a reminder. I would also ask you to pray for this process and pray for these guys and pray for their families, that the Lord's will would be done in all of this. So the one other thing is, as we pray, I'm going to pray for Ron Richardson. Ron often serves, well, almost every week he serves on our audiovisual team in the back, and he is right now at University Hospital in Tempe. He is on a ventilator. He was tested COVID positive, and due to some other respiratory issues, he is now on a ventilator. So we're praying for God to be merciful to him and preserve his life. So let's pray together. God, we do pray for Ron and for his wife Esther and his kids, that you'd be with them. We pray that you would be merciful to Ron, spare his life. Lord, we pray that you would bring him back to our church family, that you would restore him to us. We pray that you would aid the doctors and give them wisdom and help them understand the best course of treatment. But we also recognize that you're God. You're sovereign over the human body. You're sovereign over life. You're sovereign over all things. And so we pray that according to your sovereign will and your mercy, your great grace, that you would pour out grace on Ron and his family and bring him home. And we do thank you for your word, that every word of the Lord proves true, that your promises come to pass, that you're faithful, and that you've spoken and revealed yourself to us that we might know you more. And I pray this morning that through this process of teaching and studying your word together, we would truly know you more, not just as an exercise of our mind, Father, but that deeply in our hearts we would grow in our intimacy with you, our love for you, our desire for you. And we pray these things in Christ's precious name. Amen. So I'd love for you to open with your Bible, or open your Bible with me to Genesis chapter 17. We looked at the first half of this chapter last week. Leonard was man enough to teach through that passage and address the issue of circumcision. And I'm thankful for that. You know, I just happened to be gone that week, and so he got assigned that responsibility. But we've been following Abram and Sarai in Genesis since God plucked them out of the land of Haran and gave them this command to go to the land of Canaan, the promised land. And when God chose Abram, God made a promise to him that he would bless Abram and that he would make Abram into a great nation, and that through Abram, God would bless all the nations of the earth. But there was a little problem with this promise that we've encountered through our reading. The problem is that Abram and Sarai are old. They were old when God first appeared to them. They're even older in the story now. And they have no children. And there's no children through which this promise can come to fruition. And for many years, God's promise went unfulfilled until Sarai and Abram hatched this plot to help God and bring the promise to pass according to their own ideas for how this might occur. And so Sarai gave her servant Hagar over to Abram that he might go into her and have her as another wife and through her have a son. so that God could fulfill this promise that he had made and wasn't really making good on. And the plan seemed to work, because Abram goes into Hagar and sleeps with her and has a son, and they name that son Ishmael. That's Abram's firstborn son. But after all the waiting and after this scheme for Abram and Sarai to help God by their own power, to do for him what he seemed incapable of doing by his own divine power, today we're going to see God has a different plan. He has a plan that he's been working, and the promise that he has made to Abram and Sarai, it is going to come to pass, and today it's going to come into greater focus with more particulars, more details. Now God's going to appear, not just to Abram, but to also Sarai, and he's going to explain to them how this promise is going to come to pass according to his own terms, not according to human efforts. So let's pick up in Genesis chapter 17, verse 15. And God said to Abraham, "As for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her name Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall become nations. Kings of peoples shall come from her." Then Abraham fell on his face and laughed and said to himself, "Shall a child be born to a man who is 100 years old? Shall Sarah, who is 90 years old, bear a child?" And Abram said to God, "Oh, that Ishmael might live before you." God said, "No, but Sarah, your wife, shall bear you a son, and you shall call his name Isaac. I will establish my covenant with him as an everlasting covenant for his offspring after him. As for Ishmael, I have heard you. Behold, I have blessed him, and I will make him fruitful and multiply him greatly. He shall father 12 princes, and I will make him into a great nation. But I will establish my covenant with Isaac, whom Sarah shall bear to you at this time next year." When he had finished talking with him, God went up from Abraham. Then Abraham took Ishmael his son and all those born in his house or bought with his money, every male among the men of Abraham's house, and he circumcised the flesh of their foreskins that very day, as God had said to him. Abraham was 99 years old when he was circumcised in the flesh of his foreskin, and Ishmael his son was 13 years old when he was circumcised in the flesh of his foreskin. That very day, Abraham and his son Ishmael were circumcised, and all the men of his house, those born in the house and those bought with money from a foreigner, were circumcised with him. So last week, Leonard walked us through this scene where God changes the name of Abram to Abraham, giving this man a new name, and ultimately, by giving him a new name, really giving him a new identity. And now here in verse 15, God is going to do the same thing with Sarai. Sarai is not present when this happens. That's actually kind of an important detail that will come back into play in a few minutes when we get into chapter 18. But God changes Sarai's name to Sarah. And the name actually means the same thing. It's just a minor change in the Hebrew vocalization of the name. But Sarah's name means princess. And she will indeed, after all these years of waiting, be a princess, because through her, princes will come, through her lineage. And this is a beautiful picture, because Sarah is almost 90 years old as God makes this promise, and her identity her entire life has really been as the woman who has failed to give children to her husband, Abraham. In fact, the first thing that we are told about Sarah when we met her, when we first met her back in chapter 11, verse 30, is that she's barren. And then when we see her again, we re-encounter her in chapter 16, verse 1, we're reminded of this truth regarding her identity, that she has borne no children to Abraham. This is the defining thing about Sarah. And it's really a bitter blemish upon the psyche of this woman, as she thinks even about herself, that she's failed to be a mother, especially in light of the fact that God has said these lofty promises regarding Abraham, that through him will come a great nation. So this is a great place for us, I think, to pause for a moment and just consider this concept of identity. Sarah, her identity is defined by the fact that she is a failure. That's how Scripture defines her. That's how I think she would define herself. I mean, who is Sarai? Oh, that's right. That's that old woman who has failed to give her husband Abraham the children of promise. But now God appears to her in order to give her a new identity. Or God appears to Abraham to give his wife a new identity. He speaks this new name upon her and he calls her princess. And I think there's a beautiful lesson for us to learn here, because we live in a culture that is obsessed with identity. Have you perceived that? We think about ourselves and we have a particular fixation around how we identify ourselves. We even have a political term called identity politics, which lumps people into groups based on the kind of identity that they show to the world. White or black, wealthy or poor, educated or not, immigrant or natural born, conservative or liberal. We formulate our identity regarding the places that we come from, maybe the sports team that we follow, the logos that we have on our clothes, the neighborhood that we live in, the car that we drive, the people that we choose to follow, their podcast or their Instagram or on Facebook or Twitter. And those identities, those are bad enough. To formulate your identity, the way that you think about yourself in any of those terms, that's bad enough. But it gets worse from there. We live in a culture that is obsessed with a sort of self-declared identity that can pretty much be whatever you want it to be. As if you can just imagine some reality about yourself, and then it becomes true, and then other people around you must project that identity on you. Accept that self-declared identity. But all of that is ultimately meaningless. However you might identify yourself according to any of those terms, just like Sarah, I think, identified herself as the barren one, it is ultimately meaningless. What has meaning is how God identifies us, the identity that he gives to us. And in the confusion of all of this hopelessness regarding man's obsession with self-identity and external realities as identifiers, God offers us something really beautiful. God speaks, and something wonderful, something redemptive, something transcendent occurs. God offers to us the blessing of a new identity, the way that he sees us. John chapter 1, verses 12 through 13 says that, "But to all who did receive Jesus, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God." Scripture teaches that God offers to each of us a new identity, much like he offered to Sarah a new identity. And this identity, it's not self-described. It's not culturally prescribed to us. It's not based on how we outwardly appear or how others might perceive us. It's based on what God calls us. Through faith, God offers us this new identity, not depraved, not sinner, not broken, not fallen, but child of God. And it's difficult to believe, really. I mean, if you have spent any time trying to walk in the reality of this identity, it's difficult to believe that God would see you that way and offer you that beautiful thing and call you that name. Just like Abraham and Sarah struggled to believe. They laugh. It's beyond comprehension for them. And yet it's true. However you might view yourself, the only thing that matters is that you receive Christ, the Son of God, And in receiving him, believe in this name that he has given you, this identity he offers you, child of God. True blessing is not found in identifying yourself some way. True blessing is found in receiving the identity that God offers you through Christ and living in light of that identity. Now, Abraham struggles with God's promise here, which is why he laughs. And who can really fault him for his suspicion regarding what God says is true? He struggles to reconcile the fact that his wife, who's been barren her entire life and is now pushing 90 years old, when Scripture says that the way of woman is no longer with her, Abraham is saying she's now in menopause, she's post-menopausal, she is beyond the age of childbearing, she's now going to be a mother? It is laughable. And so he tries to negotiate with God and talk God into a more reasonable, a more simple plan. After all, he's already got a firstborn son, the rightful heir to his inheritance. And it just makes sense for God to fulfill this promise through Ishmael. Ishmael's already here. He's already a young man at this point. He's already 13 years old. And so Abraham sees this very natural way by which God could achieve these goals. And so he points this out to God in verse 18. Oh, that Ishmael might live before you. God, that Ishmael, who's already here, might be the one through whom you choose to make good on all of your promises. God, I think it's time to just forget all this nonsense about this old woman, Sarah. I mean, I love her, but she's kind of past her prime. And we've already got this plan, and it's in motion, and it's actually going really well, God. Let's make this work. And God's response in verse 19 is quite simple. No. No, Abraham. Sarah's going to have a son, and he's going to be the son through whom my covenant promise comes to pass. God is unwilling to negotiate with Abraham on this point. And I want you to remember that, because actually God is going to negotiate with Abraham later, but on this point, God does not negotiate. God chooses to do things his way. And the fact of the matter is, God chooses to do things the difficult way quite often, so that it is by supernatural means that things come to pass. And this is quite often how God chooses to do things in the Scriptures. And friends, I remind you of this regularly, but I think it bears repeating consistently, because life is hard. And we can begin to think God doesn't know what he's doing when life is hard. But God loves to choose the difficult way. God loves to choose actually the impossible way. The way that you and I would stand back and go, there is just no way. And he does that so that when all is said and done, God alone gets the credit. God alone gets the glory. God alone is the famous one who has pulled these things off. And if God had agreed to Abraham's negotiation concerning this point, there might have come to pass a day when Abraham and Sarah, even in older age than they currently are, begin to believe that they themselves had done something really incredible. You know, God was with them, but really they had done something astounding. All of their blessings had come to pass because of what they had achieved. But God does not share the credit that he alone deserves with the creatures that he has made. He alone achieves great things. And so he continues his plan to do the impossible so that God alone receives the praise and the glory. Now, think about your life. As you look at the difficulties, the struggles, the hardships, maybe that you're experiencing right now or that you've experienced in the past, has it ever occurred to you that God might intentionally be making things harder for you? I like to ask this question: does your theological concept of God allow room for a God who intentionally makes things difficult for you so that when the solution finally comes, you will give praise and glory to him for what he has done to redeem you and rescue you so that you can't claim the credit. Only God deserves the glory. God chose Abraham, the nobody, to make him a great nation so that God would be glorified. Jesus chose 12 insignificant men, probably the last people on earth that you would choose to start this movement called the church, so that his power would be displayed. God chooses the foolish to shame the wise, and he chooses the weak to shame the strong, and he chose the cross to bring eternal life. What hardship might God be thrusting upon you so that when it's finally said and done, you will rest in the glory of God and give him praise for his exclusive power to lift you out of that and redeem you? I sometimes think about why God has given me a recurring burden. I sometimes think about why God has given me a recurring burden of depression that makes me wrestle and struggle, that makes me crave the Psalms for intimacy with God. And I fight hard to keep my mind set on Christ, but I, in the midst of that weakness, have to remember that through that weakness, God gets glory. Because if I was strong, I might begin to think, man, I've achieved a lot on my own. The things that I've done, I've accomplished by my own effort, by my own power, by my own strength. And the truth is, God has made me weak specifically so that I would be amazed at the impossible things that he has done in me, that he's done by me, that he's done through me, so that I can claim no credit for those things. So that I can say to others, look at what God has done. God has filled my life with challenges so that I would be codependent upon him for the grace that I need. And after receiving that grace, I would remember he alone is my rock and my salvation. God says no to Abraham's plot, because God's already made a promise to be Abraham's shield and to make Abraham's reward great, not because Abraham was ever great or could ever do anything great, but because God is great. And God wanted to show his greatness through Abraham's insignificance. And Abraham is called a man of faith because although he laughs at the absurdity of it all, and we can understand why he might do that, in his heart, Abraham does believe God, that God can do the impossible. Which is why then, after negotiating or attempting to negotiate with God and after laughing at the absurdity of it all, we see in verses 22 through 27, when God finishes speaking, what does Abraham do? After God says, this is how things are going to be, Abraham, when Abraham finishes talking with God, Abraham goes and does what God commanded him to do. He upholds his end of the covenant before God fulfills his end of the deal by bringing the promise to pass, because Abraham trusts the goodness of God. And here's another lesson for us to think about in light of Abraham's actions. The reward that we have in Christ, it has been promised to us. But the fullness of that reward has not yet come. We remain in a time of waiting. We have the down payment. Scripture says that the Holy Spirit is the deposit that we've received that makes us know for sure that the final payment will come. But we await the fullness of that reward. And for now, while we wait in weakness and in hardship, we must simply follow in the way of Abraham. Look to him and see that he acted in faith. He trusted God. He obeyed. God has made to us a promise of eternal life. And as we wait, this now is the time for faith that leads to obedience. And so we must act and trust that God will in time make good on his promise. Let's read on into chapter 18. And the Lord appeared to Abraham by the oaks of Mamre as he sat at the door of his tent in the heat of the day. Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, three men were standing in front of him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent door to meet them and bowed himself to the earth and said, O Lord, if I have found favor in your sight, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought and wash your feet and rest yourselves under the tree while I bring a morsel of bread that you may refresh yourselves, and after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servant. So they said, do as you have said. And Abraham went quickly into the tent to Sarah and said, quick, three seahs of fine flour, knead it and make cakes. And Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to a young man who prepared it quickly. Then he took curds and milk and the calf that he had prepared and set it before them. And he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, where is Sarah, your wife? And he said, she is in the tent. The Lord said, I will surely return to you about this time next year, and Sarah, your wife, shall have a son. And Sarah was listening at the tent door behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in years. The way of women had ceased to be with Sarah. So Sarah laughed to herself, saying, after I am worn out and my Lord is old, shall I have pleasure? The Lord said to Abraham, why did Sarah laugh and say, shall I indeed bear a child now that I am old? Is anything too hard for the Lord? At the appointed time, I will return to you, about this time next year, and Sarah shall have a son. But Sarah denied it, saying, I did not laugh, for she was afraid. He said, no, but you did laugh. Okay, so this is one of those Old Testament stories that I think bends the mind a little bit. God appears to Abraham, but it's in this group of three men, which might be some kind of Trinitarian veiled reference, but I don't think it is. I think God is here in some human form, and he's accompanied by two angels, but therein lies the problem with the scene. We just don't know. The text does not tell us enough information. It's strange and it's vague. We're told that the Lord appears to Abraham. That is explicitly said, and three men show up. And at some point, the text refers to the Lord and says, they speak, and sometimes it says, he speaks. So you've got this plural and singular happening. And this is clearly, again, God, because the text says that. It says it in verse 1, and again in 10, and again in verse 13. And I think I made this clear in the past. When you see that weird formatting for the word Lord in your Bible, in the Old Testament, that is a reference to the Hebrew word Yahweh. And there's another indication that this is God, because these men know this name for Sarah, this new name, that was a divinely appointed name. So they're not just some random guys who come. They have information that only God himself could have. So this is a strange scene. We should treat it with caution when we attempt to draw conclusions about God from a text like this. There's not too many conclusions we can draw. But I think the picture of God that this text does give us allows us to say at least two things for sure. So let me zero in on those. The first is that our God is shrouded in mystery. I actually really love to read passages of Scripture from the Old Testament like this that describe God and kind of break my brain a little bit, because our God is like that. He is beyond comprehension. He's transcendent. He defies description. In this text, God is referred to both in the singular and the plural, and he speaks in the singular and the plural. And Abraham somehow perceives that he's dealing with something wonderful, something divine. Something about these men is more than mortal to him, because he goes through this extreme ritual. to provide them with a really phenomenal feast. And these men who somehow embody God, they ask the question, where is Sarah? Again, referring to her by this divinely appointed name. And they know full well where Sarah is. She is right behind the tent curtain, listening to the conversation. The point of asking the question is to get her attention. And I find myself reading this passage longing to know more about this God who is shrouded in mystery. Don't you? But the beautiful thing about a passage like this is we don't have to stop at longing or wondering or guessing or speculating. Because if we continue to read our Bible, God has chosen to reveal himself to us in Christ. God chooses to satisfy our curiosity, our desire to know him by taking on human flesh that we might know what God is like. And after all, Jesus said, if you've seen me, then you've seen God the Father. If you wonder about who God is, simply look to Christ. But this brings us to the second thing that I think this passage does teach us about who God is, which is that our God is intimate with people. Both Abraham and Sarah, they laugh at this offering that God makes to them. God makes an offering, you will have a son, and they laugh. But don't you find it interesting that God does not laugh at Abraham's offering? Did you notice Abraham's offering, verse 4? A little water to wash your feet, a rest under this tree, a morsel of bread. That is a pathetic offering to God. As extravagant as the meal ends up being, it is pathetic. This is the God who made the water, the God who made the tree, the God who made the flower and the hands that prepared it. God should have laughed at Abraham and said, what in the world could you possibly offer to me that isn't already mine, Abraham? What rest or refreshment, Abraham, could you give to me, the God of rest, who made the heavens and the earth? But God doesn't laugh at Abraham. Instead, God comes and shares this intimate moment of fellowship with him. God lets Abraham serve him while God eats his food and sits under his tree. Now, let me remind you, friends, that we are only 18 chapters into Genesis. And so let me recall to your memory what this book reveals about who God is, the God who sits with Abraham. Do you remember chapter 1? This is the God who spoke the universe into existence. The God who now sits under the shade of Abraham's tree created all of this with a word. Remember chapter 2, where God took the dust of the earth and formed it into a man and breathed the breath of life into it? That is the God now seated under Abraham's tree. Or chapter 3, where this God disciplined man for sin, banished him from his garden paradise, and inflicted him with death because this God is holy. Or what about chapter 6, where this God rent the heavens and shattered the storehouses of the floodgates of the deep to plunge the earth into a watery judgment for evil, killing all mankind except the family of Noah that he chose to save by his divine grace? That's this God. Or what about chapter 11, where God disperses the whole humanity that he has made across the face of the earth for their hubris and arrogance in an effort to teach them just a shred of humility before his face? That's this same God. Don't forget this God of Genesis who now appears to this nobody nomad named Abraham sitting under a tree to share a meal with him. The God of all time and all creation sitting at the table of Abraham, like a friend you might invite to your home to sit at your table, to break bread with you. This is our God. Shrouded in mystery, yes. Transcendent beyond our comprehension, yes. But also intimate, close, a friend of Abraham. And if we thought about it, we might be tempted to envy Abraham. Wouldn't you have loved to be sitting under that same shady tree as this moment comes to pass, sharing this fellowship with God? Wouldn't it be a wonderful thing for God to come and visit you at your home and sit at your dinner table and speak with you and break bread with you? And you know where I'm going with this, don't you? Revelation 3:20, Jesus says, "Behold, I stand at the door and I knock. And if you hear my voice and you open that door, I will come in and I will eat with you." Jesus tells us that we are invited to share a table with him like his friend might do. There's a wonderful, mysterious beauty in this passage of Genesis 18 because it shows us that God loves this man, Abraham, against all odds, against all reason. It's inexplicable, really. God has chosen him and set his love and blessing upon him. God is not insulted by this pathetic attempt that Abraham offers to provide some hospitality for God. No. Even though God fashioned the earth and the heavens, he actually delights to step into this intimate moment with Abraham and share this moment with him. And the beautiful truth is, the intimacy that Jesus offers us with God, it far surpasses the intimacy that Abraham had with God in this moment, because we know the incarnate God, God made man. We know the risen God. We know him intimately in our hearts because the Holy Spirit dwells in us and gives us fellowship with God. The mysterious God who transcends all that we can think about him, he's chosen to enter into our lives as well because he loves us and he desires to be known by us and he's decided that he wants to be near to us. That's a wonderful thing. That's a delightful thing. And God's presence alone sitting at Abraham's table, that would have been enough. I mean, if you've ever had an intimate moment with God, the way he satisfies the soul with his presence, that would be enough. But in spite of all the disbelief and shock from Abraham and Sarah, God makes a wonderful promise to them. God says, "Sarah, within a year, you're going to conceive a son." And finally, this promise, after waiting 20 years, it's got a definite time stamp to it. After all this waiting, now the clock is finally ticking. And like Abraham, Sarah laughs with the impossibility of it all, which I think, again, is understandable. But God would laugh at the simple ease of it all, wouldn't he? All the doubts that swirl in Sarah's mind, they're nothing in the mind of God. And you can almost hear the laughter in God's response to Sarah in verse 14. "Silly Sarah, is anything too hard for God? Sarah, you silly girl, is anything impossible for the Lord? Of course not." And the conversation itself reveals the power of this God, because Sarah speaks concerning her hidden thoughts to herself. She's not even officially a part of the conversation, but God hears the private laughter and he responds publicly. God will do this thing because he's God. He has the power to do anything, even the impossible things. God has promised, and so then it shall be. So let's close by reflecting on this promise for just a minute. God has not promised anyone in this room that they will have a baby in the next year. That's the promise that God specifically, particularly made to Sarah in our text. But God has made many specific and particular promises to his people, to his children who share in the faith of Abraham. And in preparation for this message, I went and quickly pulled out 14 promises from Scripture that God makes to his people in his word. And that's just a small sample. Now, for the sake of time, I won't touch on all 14 of them. Excruciatingly cut out 9 of them. So I'm going to give you 5 Okay, but I'll go quick. Five promises that God has made to you in the same way that God made promises to Abraham and Sarah, which is to say that when God makes a promise, he always delivers on that promise, even when it might seem impossible. And you might not need all five of these today. Maybe God just wants you to hear one. And if you're the note-taking type, this would be a time for you to pull out a pen and a piece of paper. First, Romans 14, 17, God promises to give to his people righteousness and peace and joy. Righteousness and peace and joy, Romans 14, 17. God promises that he is going to make you righteousness by the work and the power of his Holy Spirit. He promises that he will fill your heart with peace and joy in Christ. Now, there are many false teachers who proclaim extravagant lies about God's intention to bring material prosperity to Christians. But this is no false promise of prosperity that I'm referring you to. This is a promise that you can take to the bank that God indeed will fulfill. He will give to you in your life these great gifts of spiritual prosperity, righteousness and peace and joy through the Spirit of God alive in you. Whatever material situation you might find yourself in, God can do the impossible. He can make you righteous. He can give you peace in spite of your lack. He can give you joy in the midst of your difficulty. Second, Ephesians 6:8 and Romans 2:10, God promises that he will reward his people for their good conduct in this life. Truly, if in honoring Jesus in this life you think that you have sacrificed anything or lost anything, you have lost nothing. God promises to repay you beyond your wildest imagination. Everyone who seeks to do good with their life, to honor Christ, will be rewarded. All of the righteousness that you strive for, all the hard work that you put into honoring God, any sacrifice that you might make, it is nothing compared to the riches of glory that is being stored up for you because of your faith in Christ. Third, Romans 8:1 says that God promises that there will be no condemnation for those who place their faith in Christ. I think it's fair to assume that many people in this room struggle with shame, a sense of guilt, condemnation. You don't think that you should go before the face of the Lord because he will be disappointed in you. You're embarrassed. You think you're a failure. And one of the promises that God makes to his children is that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. The guilt and the shame, the humiliation, the disgrace, the dishonor, the regret, the condemnation, all of that was borne by Christ on the cross for your sake. And God now replaces that condemnation with love and acceptance. You are his beloved child. That is your identity. That is who you are. Fourth, James 1, verse 5 says that God will promise, or God will give to those who ask, wisdom and guidance. If you want to be wise, maybe you feel like you're at a difficult point in your life and you're not sure what to do, God says that he will give you wisdom. If you ask him for it and you seek his kingdom, God will provide you with the wisdom that you need. That's a promise. And God has given us his word that through it we might be wise. So go to Scripture. Finally, Romans 5, verses 20 to 21, God promises to make grace abound in our lives. God promises to make grace abound. Grace is God's sustaining power in our lives. Grace not only regenerates us and brings us into relationship with God, it not only redeems us out of sin, grace not only makes us new and brings us into the kingdom of God, grace daily sustains us in our journey home. And God says he's going to make grace abound so liberally that it will cover all of your sin, it will provide for all of your needs, and it will indeed bring you safely home at the end of this journey. God says grace will abound to those who believe. These are just some of the promises that God makes to you, like he made this promise to Abraham and Sarah. So let us not laugh at them. Let us not, like Abraham and Sarah, feel a sense of doubt or be overwhelmed that they might seem impossible to God. Let us simply believe in God's power to provide. And in that belief, then, let us respond like Abraham did in obedience. Let's pray. God, we thank you for this promise that you made to Abraham and Sarah, and the beautiful way in which it still to this day affects our life, because through this promise you brought Christ into our world to redeem us. And it's ultimately through Christ that all these other promises that you have made prevail. All the promises of God are yes in Christ. And God, I pray that like Abraham and like Sarah, you would give us the faith to believe and to trust and to act. That we would lean into you in weakness and doubt and failure. That we would trust you for what seems impossible. And that in that trust, we would see that our God is a rock. Our God is our salvation. Lord God, give us that faith, we pray in Christ's name. Amen.